Hello everyone, I hope you are doing well. This is Prithvi Raj here, the LitmusChaos community manager, and I welcome you all to this video where we'll be talking about the principles of cloud native chaos engineering. Chaos engineering as a technology has come a long, long way since its inception, and with so many projects and tool sets coming into the fray, LitmusChaos has been one of the front runners in redefining what cloud native chaos engineering is. So let's get started without any delay in 3, 2, 1.
Folks, as I said, today we'll be talking about the principles of cloud native chaos engineering, what exactly chaos engineering is and how the principles are driving building the right infrastructure to conduct chaos tests in your system. So moving on, just a little bit about me. My name is Prithvi Raj. I'm based out of Bhubaneswar, Odisha, India. I'm working at Chaos Native as a community manager for the Litmus Chaos project. Litmus Chaos, as you know, is a CNCF sandbox project, and I also alongside that work as a co-organizer at Chaos Carnival. We had an inaugural event this year, and Chaos Carnival is a global conference all about cloud native chaos engineering, attracting audiences as well as speakers from all around the world. Apart from that, I organize Kubernetes chaos engineering meetups every fourth Saturday of the month, and a lot of folks from, especially from India, join in to talk about chaos, learn chaos, and feel free to join in, folks, if you want to, and learn more chaos engineering with us. So moving on to the agenda, we'll be briefly talking about chaos engineering. We'll have a chaos engineering 101, why chaos, why do you need to learn chaos, or how chaos engineering helps you. Chaos engineering for Kubernetes or cloud native systems, that is what we are going to talk about. So obviously, why do we need chaos engineering for Kubernetes? Then we'll roughly talk about the principles of chaos first before defining the principles of cloud native chaos engineering. So chaos engineering, I mean, why chaos engineering, and what is chaos engineering exactly? I mean, with the infrastructure, the way infrastructure is being built today, moving in such a way where everything is complex, everything needs some amount of solution engineering, or there's obviously a requirement for scalability and resiliency and reliability, because systems are not monoliths anymore. They are, the microservices architecture has taken over the whole technology world, and today resiliency is of way more importance than it was beforehand. And resiliency of distributed systems is very complex, because there are so many systems within that bigger system that resiliency needs to be taken care of. And how does resiliency need to be taken care of? Continuous validation is key. You need to repeatedly conduct experiments, you need to repeatedly test these systems to find out if they are resilient or not. So what is chaos engineering? Chaos engineering is nothing but breaking things on purpose, or I would say breaking things on purpose to make them secure. So that is inducing an outage in a system, inducing an outage or a fault in a system deliberately in a controlled way to reduce the possibility of a future outage, to not only reduce but look forward to nullify the possibility of a future outage. What are the real life examples? You can take Netflix is the one who invented chaos engineering at the first, because what if the number of users spike if there's some series or a movie, for example Money Heist, comes in and there's a new season altogether, and there are a lot of users coming in and there's a spike. So how to make sure that there's no outage in that sort of scenario. Chaos engineering, chaos test your systems. First, figure out what's the steady state to be inducing chaos in the system. Then introduce the chaos in the system, and then observe and improve your system accordingly. Because obviously the financial impacts are very large. If there's a planned outage, then obviously you can reduce the impact, but an unplanned outage can create havoc in your organization. So why chaos engineering? Why chaos engineering for Kubernetes systems? I mean, Kubernetes is not just about your application. There are a lot more layers on your application, a lot more cloud native components which make up the infrastructure. There's your application, which is Kubernetes based. And then there are other applications such as MongoDB, Kafka, T TIKV, Vitess, which Postgres, which build make up your application. And then you use cloud native services to enhance your experience as a user, as a developer. So what sort of cloud native services you use? You might use Core DNS to make your system secure. You might use Prometheus for monitoring metrics. So these services are used along your Kubernetes systems or applications. And then there are other Kubernetes services which are part of Kubernetes itself. So there are various components. And lastly, obviously, platform services which make up your infrastructure, which help your infrastructure be what it is. So it's like a pyramid. The structure of your application is like a pyramid, and each layer of the pyramid is vulnerable to outages, is vulnerable to getting some amount of an attack. And that is why the resiliency of each layer of the pyramid is very important, hence making up Kubernetes very complex and bringing in the idea of chaos engineering to be more and more important. So obviously Kubernetes needs a resilient tool set. I mean, there's no doubt that Kubernetes must have a tool set which makes it more resilient. Traditional chaos engineering tools are obviously existing. You can find a lot of traditional chaos engineering tools. I mean, Chaos Monkey is an example developed by Netflix, but they do not solve the issues a Kubernetes system might face, because the cloud native world is complex and it doesn't suit the persona of scalability, how you scale your infrastructure, how you move about it, how complex it can get, and how chaos tests should be conducted in these sort of systems. Being the part of the SIGAP delivery, or it's known as TAGAP delivery now in the CNCF, what needs to be emphasized upon is operators. Obviously, Kubernetes operators, there are various operators that need to be emphasized upon. GitOps culture is coming up to scale your systems in a very, very structured manner. And then chaos test is, again, that is what we are talking about. What is driving it? SLOs, I mean, service level objectives. Each and every individual or an enterprise has some amount of SLOs and SLAs for their CI/CD pipelines and their overall infrastructure. And chaos engineering in their platforms come slowly, because it's something which is not adopted altogether, but there you induce chaos in your development stage, pre-staging stage, staging, and then slowly with changes coming up, you move it into your production. So moving on to the principles of chaos engineering, what exactly are the principles and how do they drive chaos engineering? So before moving on to the cloud native principles, let's just talk about the principles of chaos engineering. So I'll be sharing a website which is called principlesofchaos.org. I'll be sharing the link in the description as well. It's an open source project, I think, and that is where the basic principles of chaos engineering have been written. A lot of people have various principles, but somewhere these principles are devised by the scientific methodology of technology. So chaos engineering is in practice, obviously we can talk in brief about it, but you start by defining a steady state, or what exactly indicates the normal behavior of your system. How does your system behave in normalcy? What exactly does it do? And then you hypothesize the steady state so that you can differentiate between a control group and the experimental group. What is in your control and what do you need to experiment? What might need experimentation and is vulnerable to an outage? Then you introduce variables that reflect real world events, which happens usually. So for example, a crash or a malfunction or some sort of an attack, some sort of a hack. So network connections going down. So you introduce such variables, and then you try to disprove the hypothesis by looking for a difference in the steady state between the control group and the experimental group. So the control group is what is actually going ahead with the real world events, and the experimental group is the one on which you conduct your experiments. So now moving on to the advanced principles, as I said, build a hypothesis around steady state. So you need to focus on the outputs of the system rather than just the internal attributes of the system or how the system might react to the output in a short period of time. So you need to build a hypothesis around how does your system behave when it is in steady state. And then you need to think about the real world events, because the real world events may vary. It might be according to the hypothesis, or it might not be according to the hypothesis. Any event which is capable of disrupting your steady state is potentially vulnerable to attacks, and it's basically requires a chaos test, a chaos experiment. So then you move on, through your hypothesis, through the real world events, you start running experiments in production. You run experiments in production, and chaos strongly prefers to experiment directly on production traffic. I mean, eventually you have to move your system into production, right? So you need to understand how system behave differently in different traffic patterns, because traffic is not equivalent or is not equal at one point of time. So you try to check out how various traffics or noises change your system, and then you induce chaos accordingly, and then you automate the experiments so that you don't have to run them manually. Because initially you run them manually, but what happens is slowly you move on to automate these experiments so that they can be run by themselves. And lastly, you minimize the blast radius. I mean, experimenting in production can obviously cause unnecessary pain to the customer if you do it directly. It might have a short term or a long term negative impact, you don't know. And chaos engineering is a powerful practice. So you need to minimize your blast radius so that you can induce these chaos tests responsibly. So as I said, these are the basic principles of chaos engineering, and that is what helped us devise the principles for cloud native chaos engineering. So how is chaos engineering, or how is the resiliency built with the principles? Obviously, as you can see, you build a resilience. How do you build resilience? You identify the steady state. You identify the steady state of the system, and then you move ahead by introducing a fault. You introduce a fault, and that is where you understand if the steady state conditions are regained or not after introducing a fault. And once if the steady state conditions are regained, then yes, your system is resilient. But what if the steady state conditions are not regained? Then no, you have found a weakness. And this is a continuous process which goes on to build resiliency in a system. So if your system is resilient to that chaos test, then you inject a new fault. You test how can the system react to some different kind of fault. But if there's a weakness, then you fix the weakness, you introduce a fault again. And then this process goes on in a cyclic motion. And it continues until your system, I mean, resiliency is a continuous process. Your systems can never be completely resilient. So with that, the Litmus community or the Litmus Chaos project devised some principles which drove cloud native resiliency, which are the basic factors of driving cloud native resiliency. And what are they? It must be open source. It must be, obviously, open source is the key. We'll move on to describing the principles later on, but these are the few principles: open source, community collaborated, open API and lifecycle management, KitOps, and open observability. We'll talk about them later on, but let's see how is it done in a diagrammatic form. So identify the steady state conditions again, as you saw, introduce a fault, and then does your SLO or SLI is continued to be met? The focus is on SLO, service level objectives, which are basically where we talk about if the system resiliency is met or not. If the SLOs are met, then yes, the system is resilient. If not, no, weakness is found. And that is how Litmus as well works as well. The chaos engineering custom resource where the operator pulls a chaos experiment CR, the chaos runner helps running the chaos experiment, and then the chaos result CR helps us display if the experiment has passed or failed. So it moves in cyclic motion again, and that is how cloud native chaos engineering happens. But talking about the aspects, the various principles of cloud native chaos engineering, open source, obviously a project, open source is the future. With open source projects coming up, it encourages broader community participation. Everyone comes in, everyone contributes to the project, everyone gets to know what is happening around the project, who is contributing, who is suggesting a change. So open source is key to developing the project in a better way. It obviously reduces your cost, there's minimum expense, and the quality of the software is better than you expect in a closed source project. Integrated management, everything is integrated together and the management also functions that way. There's one place where you can check out all the information, everything which is going on in the project, and you don't need to lurk around various places. And that is where it helps manage the project better. It helps drive cloud native technologies better. Scalability, obviously, as I mentioned, scalability is this key. Your project has to be scalable. Your solution has to be scalable. And lastly, simple license management. I mean, with closed source projects or with projects which are not open source, there's a lot of issue with managing various licenses. Time and again they expire, and all these things curb the development of the project. But with open source, the license management also develops in a very, very simpler way. Community collaboration, as you see, there are a host of possible failures in the platform. There are a host of failures that can be possible. It can be cloud or on-premise. So obviously it's very important for anyone to focus on how community can come in and how community can help prevent these failures, share their use cases, because there are various use cases. Giving an example of a simple community, I would talk about Litmus itself, that there are use cases from the banking sector, the telco sector, the financial payment gateway sector, the automobile sector. So various folks come in from various enterprises or as developers, and then they talk about the use cases which help develop a project, help add features to the project. So community collaboration is very important, because platforms to provide a simple interface, the community needs to exercise these faults. The community needs to exercise chaos tests in their own systems to develop the platform. And obviously, if I'll just take an example of what community collaboration brings up, you can see better support. Obviously, the community also comes into support, and the community also talks about how these issues can be resolved or what else can be added. But Chaos Hub is a very good example of what a community can contribute and what exactly can come up when community comes together. It's a marketplace where everyone contributes the chaos experiments, and it's a one place where all the chaos experiments can be found. You can see there are 50, 53, 54 experiments out there, and all these experiments, including the generic ones or AWS VMware, have come up with community collaboration, community suggestion. A few experiments have been submitted by the community. So that is what community collaboration is, and that is what brings up the development of cloud native chaos engineering. Then moving on, open API and lifecycle management. I mean, we spoke about community collaboration and how community collaborates to talk about real world events, but let's talk about the use cases, how it is necessary to standardize the operating characteristics, and how the lifecycle of the experiment moves, and you need to publish the APIs to achieve community collaboration. I mean, if there has to be an open API for folks to pull out the experiment, and even if, for example, I'll give you an example. We talk about chaos engineering for Kubernetes, but chaos engineering can be there for non-Kubernetes systems as well. They're required for legacy systems as well. But in the cloud native forum itself, there are not just Kubernetes workloads, but workloads based on Azure, AWS, VMs, so bare metal. So it's very, very important for everyone to talk about how these DevOps teams can build tooling scripts and integrate their pipeline seamlessly. It's very important to emphasize on how chaos engineering can come up for non-Kubernetes scenarios. And that is why it's very important to have an open API, so that even if Litmus or any chaos engineering tools runs in a Kubernetes control plane, it can be pulled through the API, network API, and can be run in a non-Kubernetes infrastructure as well. Kubernetes CRDs, I mean, there are already standard APIs defined for chaos engineering, and with the BYOC feature or bring your own chaos feature, it becomes easier to have an open API and a lifecycle management. You can write your own experiment through the SDK, software development kit, and you can conduct chaos, which helps you not just depend upon the community or the maintainers of the project, but it's also, it makes you self-sufficient. It helps you write your own experiment and induce these chaos, which, you know, involves specifying the target application or service or the infrastructure component. GitOps, as I said, it's a practice of integrating chaos into continuous delivery. It is very important to integrate chaos in your CI/CD platforms, and specifically CD. The CD flow needs to be tested with chaos experiments, and they are stored in a Git repo, and then they are referenced or executed upon specific triggers. That's how GitOps comes into play. It makes the various stages in a pipeline scalable, or it actually, chaos can be injected via dedicated stages, and that is how GitOps comes into play, helping the practicing of chaos engineering and obviously automating your updates in the cluster, and your GitOps control and integrations are automated with different CD frameworks. There are various CD frameworks out there, kept in one of the CNCF sandbox projects, and it's again helps you automate your clusters using GitOps. It's a quality gates based project, and Orgo CD. With Orgo CD, you can create chaos engineering workflows. What happens is you can scale chaos tests in series or parallel, and you can conduct them as you want. You can have multiple chaos experiments working at the same time, making your chaos engineering journey easy. Lastly, open observability. I mean, it as you build a solid hypothesis around a steady state, it's very important to build this hypothesis. You need to observe. So the observation comes as a first step. And then again, you need to observe when the chaos test is already induced, and you need to see how is the chaos testing going on and what exactly you're getting as metrics, your logs, your events, your trackers. So obviously you need to observe and measure anything from application to infrastructure to downstream metrics. This is very important. And obviously these metrics help you generate useful information to see how your application is going to react, the behavior, and somewhat chaos engineering, the probes and the metrics that can be used to create dashboards, the interleaved dashboards, we'll move on to that in the next slide, is very important to have better observability when you are inducing cloud native chaos. So as you can see, I mean, these are a few examples of the metrics or open observability, how you can observe chaos when your flow control, your efficiency, cluster size. You can see the red sections where chaos is being induced and what is the situation of your infrastructure at that point of time. And this is observed in a dashboard, Grafana dashboard with Prometheus metrics. And that is how you can see that when open observability comes into play, the cloud native chaos engineering journey becomes easier. So with this, I come to the end of my presentation. I hope you liked the way I explained what the principles of chaos engineering are. If you have any questions, then feel free to drop them in the comment section. Do subscribe to the Litmus Chaos channel, because we are going to come up with more and more exciting videos. And I hope you keep following Litmus and get your chaos engineering journey started right away. Thank you, everyone. Cheers.